Welcome to our 4th of July service as we celebrate Independence Day today. We've got several announcements. I'll start with Carol. Where's Carol? Get up front.
Our ladies group had such a fun time the other day. God blessed us with holding off the rain until we were ready to leave. The drops started coming, and we really had a nice time, fun time. And it was so much fun, we're going to do it again. Only this time, it's going to be on a Friday, July 16th, at Tom and DeRay's house. The park got just a little noisy, and so we said, well, let's try it. So DeRay said, come to my house. So it'll be July 16th, 10 o'clock in the morning at DeRay's house. So I'll put an email out, and if you have any questions, feel free to call me.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Terry.
Morning. Just want to thank everybody for their donations for the bazaar. We've got a pretty good turnout, so I thank you for that. If you do have any other items that you want to bring, Sunday's a good time to bring them because then we can shoot right over after church and then just drop them off at the Montessori school. So just let me know if you have any items, and we can certainly do that. Just want to also just remind people to collect grocery bags. So we have something to put things in, that would be great. And you can bring those the day of, that's fine. And I think right now things are going well, so I just want to say thank you. And if you have any questions, let me know. Thanks.
I have a note from Jan Rostron. She was feeling under the weather, but she asked me to read this to the congregation. If you remember, Terry Dudley, a longtime faithful member, passed away. And there's a memorial service for her on Friday, July 16th. It'll be held at the West Lebanon Congregational Church on Maple Street in West Lebanon. That was a church that she was a longtime member of before she came over to be part of our church. They need help with the food for the gathering afterwards. They expect 75 to 100 people. And if you can bring the food by 11 on the 16th, or the day before between 10 and 2. They need veggies for veggie trays, sandwiches. They'll cut them in half, okay. The fruit, they will put it on the trays, just bring the fruit. Cookies or bars, crackers and cheese. And if you can let Jan know what you're bringing, her phone number is 802-295-7267. But by July 11th, if you could let her know. And she's in the church directory if you didn't get the number. Also, as we celebrate this Independence Day, today is also a communion day, that we get to celebrate the independence from guilt and shame and the burden of sin. So let us rejoice in that today. And with that, take a moment and greet your neighbor.
There's no verse 2. I can be the camera holder.
I can't see that far. You have better eyes than me.
The print is too close to the page, really.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
There you go.
If we could find our way back to our seats, please. If we could find our way back to our seats, please. Especially this one. So you may notice we don't have any instruments up here. So Chris put some videos together, and the three of us are going to see what we can do to escort you guys into a position to receive the Holy Spirit in worship. So please receive the call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Sing your song.
Bless the Lord. Yeah.
missed alone, my hope is found, and he is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. The power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny.
Voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know.
When I You'll have every failure, God. You'll have every victory.
To meet with you. We came here to experience you, Father God. So join us in the Holy Spirit. Talk to us through the prayer. Talk to us through the verses. Talk to us through the sermon and the remaining singing, Father God. And we are here to worship and to glorify you in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
You've probably heard of dual personality disorder. That's what this summer is. Can't decide if it's April or July. It's crazy. Today is April. A couple days from now will be July in California. Anyway, we pray as a congregation. We actually come and bring our petitions and praises to him. We believe he's here. And every other week we do it. Like we're going to do it today. It's called Popcorn Prayer. I'll lead you in a time of reflective praise. I hope you join with me in your hearts. And then there'll be a time for you to bring your own petitions and praises to God. And we just use a word or a name or just a phrase to entrust that issue that we're thinking about into God's hands, knowing that he knows how to take care of it. So join me in as we pray. Father, I thank you for the stories of Holy Scripture. The real narratives of history, of your interaction with people, right at the beginning. Think of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, great heroes of the faith. And the more you read about them, the more you realize, I guess what we would say is that they had clay feet. They were far from perfect, but they were your people. You'd chosen them. And we get a real sense of your intimate interaction with the people of who upon whom you've set your love. You walked with them. You met them where they were. You didn't abide their sin in the sense that you thought it was okay, but you maintained your faithfulness to them. I remember Jacob saying, you were his shepherd all of his life. For a good portion of his life, he was running away from the shepherd, a sheep flying as fast as he could to get his freedom. And we thank you, Father, that in many ways our own experience corresponds to that. You are the faithful, loving Father. You're the everlasting God. You've summoned us to yourself. And we know ourselves all too often to be wayward, disobedient, far from what we know we ought to be. Yet you've never failed us and never forsaken us. Thank you for that reality. Thank you for the assurance of it in Jesus Christ our Lord, for his death in our behalf, the testimony to the depth of your love for us. You made him who knew no sin to be sin in our behalf in order that we might become the righteousness of God in him. And you said, you demonstrate your own love for us in this, in that while we're still sinners, Christ died for us. The testimony in the center of history, there is a cross that is a loud and obvious statement that you've loved us with an everlasting love, and for that reason you've continued your faithfulness to us, and there is no way that it is even possible that you can that you could love us more than you love us right now. And you invite us to know you and to walk with you as we are. We come to you through the blood of Christ, far from perfect, but cleansed, without fault in your eyes. You see us through his death and through his resurrection, through his life. And so we have an intimate personal relationship with you. Thank you, Lord God, for that. And I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to take that seriously. To ourselves, respond to your faithfulness. Take advantage of the opportunities you've given us to know you better, to seek you in your word, to pray. Thank you that we call you shepherd and Lord and Father, the faithful one, a refuge, a strength, and ever-present help in trouble. Thank you that that marks our experience. And thank you, Lord God, that you care enough about us to listen to our petitions, to our prayers. You know our needs before we bring them, but you want us to express them to you. And then the most amazing thing is that you intervene in our behalf. It's just stunning. We see it again and again. So help us, Lord God, to act in faith and bring our prayers to you. Today we also want to thank you, Father, for the privilege of living in this country. We know it's not perfect, never has been. In some ways it's far from perfect now. So we ask, Lord God, that you would intervene in the minds and hearts of our leaders to recognize that what they do in full sight of your vision. You see exactly what they do. That you're their creator and king and judge, and they will stand before you one day. We pray the same for ourselves. We need that as well, Lord. And we ask you that we would be faithful as salt and light in our world. But we are grateful, Lord, for the privilege of living here. And help us to be witnesses to your glory. I pray for the remainder of our time together, Father, that you'd be honored, that you would meet us in the Lord's Supper, and that we'd be able to encourage each other. In the name of Christ, amen.
Reading this morning is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 11 to 21. 2 Corinthians 5, 11 to 21. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known to God, and I hope it is known also to your conscience. We are not about commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast about outward appearance, not about what is in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ controls us. But we have concluded this, that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh. We regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For a sake, he made us to be sin who know no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Please turn your Bibles to Galatians chapter 6 and verse 11. I know it's not in the bulletin, but on the weeks we have the Lord's Supper, I just let God show me what he wants me to preach from. The only thing is it's always focused on the cross. So it's Galatians chapter 6 and verse 11. Galatians is in the New Testament. It's after Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, and before Ephesians and Philippians. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 11. Paul is coming to the conclusion of his letter, and he says, look at what large letters I write to you in my own hand. Everyone who wants to make a good showing in the flesh compel you to be circumcised only in order that they might not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. For not even those who are persecuted keep the law, but they wish you to be circumcised in order that they might boast in your flesh. But may it never be true of me that I boast in anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom the world is crucified to me and I to the world. Let's pray. Father, some of the things that are talked about here are not particularly hot issues in the contemporary world. The issue of circumcision is hardly a big one now. But the fundamental issue that he addresses here is very, very important to us. The possibility of compromise and the lens through which we need to look at our world in order to understand and be faithful to you. Both of those things are very, very important. And I pray, our Father, that today we might be able to hear your voice and recognize that it's you speaking to us. And because we've heard your voice, that we might be enabled by the Holy Spirit to embrace what you're teaching us and put it into practice in our lives. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Now, we would misconstrue Paul's intention here if we thought that he were treating his opponents with contempt for their desire to, as he says, make a good showing in the flesh so they won't be persecuted for the cross of Christ. That's what it says in verse 12. He's not putting them down. He doesn't treat them contemptuously because of that. Paul well knew the fear of facing public scorn and ridicule, and also the possibility of physical violence from an audience that despised his proclamation. If you read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, you can see this. He said, "When I came to you, brothers, I did not come in superiority of speech or of wisdom when I proclaimed to you the mystery of God, because I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you, notice, in weakness and in fear and in much trembling." He was shaken. He had experienced persecution and failure in his own mind in all the places he had on that missionary tour. He'd even been beaten with rods and thrown into prison. And here he is doing it again. And he's three times in the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul, we find God in his experience, we find God coming to him in a night, in a vision, to allay his fears. One's in Acts chapter 18, and verse 9, if you want to flip there quickly. If not, just listen. The Lord said in a vision at night to Paul, stop being afraid, but speak and do not be silent, because I am with you and no one will harm you, for I have a large people here. That command of Jesus implies something. It's a present negative imperative, which means what's going on now, you got to put to a stop. He was afraid. And who can blame him? He says, stop being afraid. I'm with you. I've got a great work for you to do here. Don't be silent. After he was arrested in Acts 23, verse 11, they attempted to beat him to death, basically. He was put on trial. Jesus appears to him and says, don't be afraid. Just well, as you've borne testimony to me in Jerusalem, you're going to do it in Rome. And then when he was in on a storm at sea at night, he said an angel came and appeared to me and assured me that I was going to make it. You see, Paul knew fear. He knew the temptation of being afraid. And for this reason, I take this sentence here as a serious warning that Paul felt compelled to give to the Galatians and to us. You see, for five chapters, Paul had made a closely reasoned passionate argument against the false teaching that he mentions here, and in defense of the message of the gospel of the grace of God and the message of Jesus. His argument is based upon scripture, it's based upon the Bible, it's based upon the facts of history, which were publicly available. It was based upon the Galatians' own experience of grace and the logic of the gospel, the logic of the message of Jesus. And if you read those chapters, you can see Paul's case was airtight. He had destroyed the teaching of the false teachers. He wasn't adding to his argument. Now he gives a word here concerning the motive of the false teachers. And this is not to be construed as an ad hominem attack. You know how people do that. You're making an argument, and they insult you, and they think that settles the case. Or, as we call it today, it's called deconstruction. That's why you're making a case for something, and they take your words and say, this implies that you believe this, this implies you believe that, and they call you something, a racist or something else. And for that reason, they don't have to answer your argument. They just say, this is the motive you're using, you have here for saying this, so I'm going to dismiss it. That's not what Paul's doing here. He's already made his case. He's giving a warning to the Galatians and to us. And this is his warning. Pressure to compromise our faith in the truth and the convictions of about the gospel and Christian obedience, and the pressure to compromise Christian obedience is hard to resist. That's the warning. And there's a reason he says it's hard to resist. Because we're vulnerable to social pressure. To conform our views and our lifestyle to our society, to friends, to our bosses, to our employee, to our colleagues, and to the political party we may be affiliated with, or to the club we're involved with. And you know what I mean. The New Testament has a very definitive teaching about sex, and it's starkly different than contemporary worldview. No question. Premarital sex is forbidden. A homosexual practice is called sin in the Bible. There's no missing that. If you believe that today and say it publicly, you're going to be called a hater. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You could not imagine a more all-inclusive and exclusive claim. And the Bible says, the whole Bible affirms that there's only one God, and that if you worship any other God, the Bible calls it idolatry. And if you believe that today, you're called arrogant, And people will ask you, do you think I'm going to hell if I don't believe in Jesus? And you don't know what to say. You want to give a nuanced response about the love of God and your own continuing friendship, but they want a stark answer. And it won't do you much good. And if that happens, they'll consider you a hater. More recently, the people have been asking for affiliation to views of racial justice that are completely contrary to Scripture. It is an historical fact, and we need to acknowledge this as Americans. Until the middle of the 1960s, white supremacy reigned supreme in the south of our country in the Jim Crow laws. And it was because of the indifference of the North that it could continue like that. Then there was a civil rights revolution through Martin Luther King, and the law changed, and it's taken about 25 years for all of that to work itself out. So now I think in law, racism isn't allowed, and I think in most people's hearts that's true. So we have to acknowledge that, but that there's a vision of racial justice today that is not, has nothing to do with what the Bible says. Some outspoken people, for instance, if you say there's only one race, the human race, and everybody's made in the image of God, and there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor male nor female, we're all one in Christ Jesus, and we're all equal before the cross. Do you realize that there are people who are vehement, who say that kind of talk is part of white supremacy? They really say this. Now, that's Martin Luther King's view, by the way. But they actually say that because you're trying to maintain the status quo, which they consider to still be white supremacy ruling the day. And so people today are challenged, Christians today are challenged to support organizations whose commitments and views the Bible considers false and evil. And if you don't do it, you're called a racist. That kind of thing can happen. By your friends even, by your colleagues. In a divided world, there's not much chance for explanation frequently. And if you don't fall in with slogans that you want to understand the meaning of, often you're labeled and excluded. In Paul's case, what he's addressing here is the response of the Jewish people, not all of them, of course, but to the gospel of Jesus, the response to the Christian message. They had a hard time with the idea of a crucified Messiah because the Bible says that anybody who dies on a tree, who's hung on a tree, is under the curse of God. And the Christian's response was, of course he died under the curse of God. He did it in our place. The other problem was the notion of Jewish nationalism. If you read the Bible, because of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the Jewish nation, no question, the Bible says they're God's people by virtue of their lineage. And they would add to that, the only way to be right with God is to join that nation. And, you know, there's truth in that. The New Testament says that every Gentile who comes to faith in Christ is grafted into the tree that has its roots in Abraham. Then they added, so in order to be a follower of God, you can, yeah, believing in Jesus is okay, but you have to be circumcised, and you have to take on the law, including the ceremonial law and the traditional interpretation of the law. And Paul says, no, there's a line we can't cross. And the Jewish Christians were under tremendous pressure to conform to this. Now, you have to understand that the message of the New Testament teaches that Jews and Gentiles who trust in Jesus have equal standing before God. Without circumcision, without becoming socially Jewish, and without keeping the ceremonial law or the traditional interpretation of law. The truth is, what the Bible says is that Jesus fulfilled the law. He obeyed it perfectly. And it also teaches this, that all of those ceremonies that have to do with approaching God, the priesthood, the sacrifices, and all those things about ritual cleansing, were pointers. They had a lesson. They pointed us to Jesus because they taught us that we could not approach God without sacrifice and without the shedding of blood. And since Jesus came as our sacrifice and as our priest and died on the cross in our place, he fulfilled that. All those pictures were fulfilled by him. And so what the New Testament would say is you're still teaching the law. You're still teaching the sacrifices. You're still teaching the ceremonies. You're just teaching their true meaning is pointing to Jesus. And you're still obeying them all when you come to Christ. But you don't have to do them or practice them anymore because they've been abolished since Jesus fulfilled them. We're cleansed once for all forever by the blood of Jesus Christ when he died on the cross for our sins and rose again. But some, because of social pressure to compromise at this point, some of the Jewish believers insisted that Gentiles had to become basically Jews. They had to be circumcised, they had to keep the traditions, they had to keep the ceremonial law. They had to be socially and traditionally Jewish. Now look at verse 12. Let's read it in light of that, okay? Listen to what he says. As many as wish to make a good showing in the flesh, that is outwardly, these are the ones who compel you to be circumcised only in order that they might not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. You get the idea here? They were put under tremendous social pressure because they're compromising allegiance to the law and to the nation of Israel, and all these Gentiles were coming in. And they were put under tremendous social pressure. They said, hey, I know what I'll do. If we can get the Gentiles to be circumcised and keep the traditions and keep the law, then we will not be seen as being disloyal to the commonwealth, and we will be loved and accepted as part of the family of God that we, the way we always had. That's what Paul is saying. The reason they're trying to get you to do this is because they don't want to be persecuted by their family and friends and their religious compatriots. And so they where it comes to this implication of Jesus' cross, they're compromising it and teaching you that. These were Christians. Paul says they were Christians. In Philippians, he talks about the trouble they were causing him in preaching Christ. He meant they were really preaching Jesus. They added some things that weren't true. That's what Paul is talking about. And he says the reason for that is they wanted to make a good showing in the flesh, because they didn't want to be persecuted by their brother Jews for the stand they'd made. In other words, the social pressure got to them, and that's why they were compromising. Now, Paul isn't saying that's to put them down. I think he knew what the pressure was. And today we have the same thing. I have a friend who noticed after the first election, the election when Donald Trump got elected, he noticed what percentage of evangelical Christians, Bible-believing Christians, voted for Donald Trump. I guess I would call him a liberal Christian, a liberal, politically liberal. He was a Christian. He was so offended by that he began to drift in his faith. And I tried to explain to him, I said, you know, most of the friends I had looked at the choices and went, I guess I'll go this way. Didn't matter. For him, that was too much. I went, this is the reason you're drifting from the gospel? It wasn't that, it was his friends were upset at evangelicals for voting this way, and there was Scott, the evangelical. I have another friend who says she's doubting the Bible's teaching on homosexuality and transgenderism and abortion. She's a progressive. And she accuses political conservatives who are Christians of interpreting the Bible through the lens of their political affiliation. I think that's probably true. We all fall into that from time to time, and we should be very careful about it. I could give you some examples, I'm not gonna get into it, but she's doing the same thing. And under the pressure of association with her friends, whom she loves, and she should, she's having doubts. It has nothing to do with the logic of the case, it has to do with her affiliation. And I've seen on the internet, frequently, young Christians say, I'm a Christian, but I believe these things. No argument given for believing that, just the desire to belong to the friends that they already have. You know, we all have a desire to belong, to be loved, to be accepted, to be considered normal. And that's a normal and positive thing, but we have to recognize that it's dangerous. There is frequently no good argument for compromise. You know what Jesus said? It's in John 5. Very interesting. He gave an incredibly good series of arguments about his his claims about his relationship to the Father. But then he said this, verse 44, how can you believe if you seek glory from one another and do not seek the glory that comes from the only God? If you want to be honored by your friends and colleagues, and that's your fundamental commitment, it's going to be impossible for you to be maintain your faithfulness to God. It's impossible. You got to make a choice. Martin Luther said this, if I profess with the loudest voice and clearest exposition every portion of the truth of God, except precisely that little point which the world and the devil are at that moment attacking, I am not confessing Christ, however boldly I may be professing Christ. Where the battle rages, there the loyalty of the soldier is proved. And to be steady on all the battlefield besides is mere flight and disgrace if he flinches at that point. Paul knew that the real temptation was to succumb to social pressure, and he gives us a warning here by looking at what happened to these men who were followers of Christ. They wanted to make a good showing in the flesh because they didn't want to be persecuted by the people who were important to them. So what's the cure? He says we need to look at life through the lens of the cross. Look at verse 14. To me, may it never be true that I boast in anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. And notice this phrase, through which, that is through the cross, the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Now, I wish we had time to look at the first half of that verse, but we don't. I'm just going to pass right on by it. Paul was saying that he sees the world through the lens of the cross. And that's how he can maintain his commitment. Now, you have to, first of all, we need to understand what the Bible says, what the Bible means by world. There are three ways the word world is used in the Bible, specifically the New Testament. One is the natural world, what God made. And the Bible says that is good. It certainly has been subjected to futility. It's not all that it should be. That's why I have ants on my desk. On my desk upstairs. In my kitchen, that's part of the futility, okay? But it's good, okay? Then there is the world, which means every human being. And there's no question about what the Bible says about that. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God demonstrates his own love for us in this, and that while we're still sinners, Christ died for us. The evidence of the love of God is the cross of Jesus Christ, and it's the cross that was for the whole world. The world, seen as the collection of men and women and children all across the world, is beloved by God. It's made by God, loved dearly. That's why he poured out his blood. For reasons buried in the mystery of God, human beings are of infinite value to him. But there's a third sense in which the Bible uses world, and that's the sense that he uses here. It's human society organized in opposition to God. Human society in sin and fallenness with values and mores and outlooks. He says we need to look at that through the cross as well. And he says through the cross, the world is crucified to him. What does he mean? It's hanging there on a cross under the condemnation of God. What do I mean? Well, more to the point, what does Paul mean? There's this song, it's one of my favorites on the cross. It's called Stricken, Smitten, and Afflicted. It's not a song title that's particularly attractive, but it's about the cross. And I think it's the third verse goes like this. Ye who think of sin but lightly, you don't think sin's that important. Ye who think of sin but lightly, nor suppose the evil great, here may view its nature rightly. He's talking about the cross now. Here may view its nature rightly. Here its guilt may estimate. How do you know how bad the world's sin is? Look at the cross. Then he says, mark the sacrifice appointed. Think of the suffering of Jesus and that horrible cry, my God, how, why have you forsaken me? That's God's verdict on the sin of the world and their present condition. See who bears the awful load. 'Tis the Word, the Lord's anointed, Son of Man and Son of God. If the Son of God had to die that kind of death for the sins of humankind, I don't think you get to get a brighter or more stark and obvious view of God's attitude toward humanity in its organization against God. It is condemned. It's repudiated. Loved just like a wayward son or a wayward daughter. You don't love their sin. You don't love what they're doing to themselves in self-destruction. You don't love their attitude toward everything you taught them, but you still love them. And that's what we have here. And Paul says, when I look at the world, that's what I see. I see them through the lens of the cross, and I see them under the condemnation of God. So the question comes, shall we choose the world's approval? Shall we seek its affirmation? Or live for its praise? We must measure the mirth, the worth of the acceptance and praise and affirmation of the world through the lens of the cross. Beloved, yes, absolutely, no question. But condemned and repudiated in terms of its mores and commitments just as well. It's not that everything that the world thinks and does is all wrong. Of course not. They're made in the image of God. But as a system and in sum, that's the way God looks at it. There's no missing it. That's what Paul meant. And then he says, through the cross, I am crucified to the world. So Paul says, I'm hanging on that cross with reference to the world. What does he mean by that? Well, I think there's help if you flip back to Galatians 2 and verse 20. He said, I have been crucified with Christ. What he means is because I trusted in Jesus who died on the cross for my sins and rose again, he died under the just sentence of God for all the sins of all humanity. And because I trust in him, his death counts for me. It also means, though, because I've trusted myself to him, my old life is over. Done. I've repudiated it, and this is where I'm going. He says, and I no longer live. The old I is gone, but Christ lives in me. The new identity is established by the presence of Jesus Christ because he died for me and rose again. I'm united with him. And the life, notice, in the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and delivered himself up for me. I don't care about the approval of anybody else. I live for one person, the one who died and rose for me and loved me. If you took a 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the reading we had earlier, it's very interesting. Very relevant. Verse 11. He said, knowing therefore the fear of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are manifested to God, and I hope that we are manifested in your consciousness. In other words, he's saying, I hope that you see us as you ought to, that your conscience makes a bright evaluation of our behavior. We're not again commending ourselves to you, but we're giving you an opportunity of boasting on our behalf in a way you might have an answer for those who boast in the outward appearance and not in the heart. There were people that were putting Paul down and teaching falsehood in Corinth, and Paul wanted them to know that he was worthy of their, that his message was worthy of their obedience. But then he says this in verse 13, for whether we are out of our mind, that's for God. Paul had been accused of being crazy. And you know what? If you look at it from a certain angle, there's a pretty good case to be made. He'd go into a town. He would go to the synagogue. They'd invite him to speak because he was a rabbi. And within a couple of weeks, usually, he got thrown out. And so then he'd start preaching in public. And the people would gather together and beat him up and throw him in prison and run him out of town. He did this in town after town after town. And he never stopped. He never learned his lesson. Never shut up. You know, from the perspective of the world, that's nuts. And Paul says, if you think I'm crazy, just leave that to God. And then he says his motive. Verse 14, for the love of Christ compels us. Since we have come to this rational conclusion, one died for all, therefore all died. And he died for all in order that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for the one who died for them and was raised. The love of Christ compels us, he says. It's a word. The way to understand is to think of all the ways you could translate it. It encircles us. The love of Christ encircles us. It hems me in. It controls me. It rules me. It holds me prisoner. It guards me. What does he mean by all this? There's a song that was popular in the, I was in college. It's a long time ago. Man, it's been a long time. No. 80s. Goes like this, the part that's important. We are the reason that he gave his life. We are the reason that he suffered and died. For a world that was lost, he gave all he could give. And he is our reason to live. That's what Paul meant. As far as the world goes, I'm dead. It doesn't have any effect on me because I have one focus, and that's living the one who died for me and rose again. For him. You look at the end of Paul's life, this is amazing. It's really encouraging. He's writing a letter to Timothy. He knows he's going to be executed. When you're doing that, you're reviewing your life. How have I done, right? Of course you would do that. Thinking about everything you've done. Have I done what I wanted to do? And I love this. He says in verse 7, this is his evaluation of his life. I fought the good fight. He often pictured the Christian life as a fight. And he says, I fought the good fight. And the phrase, I have fought, means I'm still in the fight. But I'm on, what does he mean by the good fight? Doesn't mean he won the fight. He didn't win the fight. It's not over. But he's still fighting the right side. That's all he means. I haven't joined the other side. They said, I finished the race. He didn't say I won the race. I just got in the end. And the last one is the most amazing. I've kept the faith. I'm still a believer. Paul knows what it's like. He recognizes that we need grace from God in order to maintain faithfulness in a world that sometimes despises the message and treats us in ways that won't even listen to our explanations. It's going to happen. And so he takes up his pen, and when you wrote a letter in those days, you said it. Could you imagine being Paul's amanuensis, his secretary, as he's writing this thing, he's saying these things, writing it out? And you didn't take up the pen till the end, and then you'd write out your name or maybe a small greeting, like he said, grace with you all, and then your name. That way they'd know it was from you, because they could recognize your writing. That was all that was for. In this letter, he takes up his pen, and he writes a long paragraph. Wrong for writing it like that. And why? Because he thought it was so important that we recognize the real temptation here is to succumb to social pressure, to want to make an outward showing for our friends and our neighbors, and so we can not be persecuted for our stance. He warns us, and he gives us the way to resist that, and that is through the lens of the cross, to recognize as much as we love our friends as we ought to, because God does and everybody else, the world is a system with its mores and values and outlooks. Look at the cross. That's the evaluation we need to make of it. And also recognize that we are crucified to the world. That is to say that we belong to Jesus by virtue of that cross. And that's the person for whom we live. It gets down to that. It gets down to that. Let's pray. There are so many ways, Lord God, in which you challenge us to look at the world through the lens of the cross. I remember what Jesus said after Judas left and he knew what he was going to do. And he said, now is the Son of Man glorified and God is glorified in him. Now the greatness of God and the Son of God is going to be seen. Love and justice, compassion and wrath, mercy, and condemnation all in the same act. A vivid picture of the greatness of Jesus Christ seen in the cross. And you teach us to look at evil in the world through that lens, recognizing that that's what you did to cure it. That's how much you love the world despite its evil. That's how much you love us. And that's what the values and attitudes and praise the world is worth. I pray, our Father, that more and more in our lives, we might see our world through the cross of Jesus Christ and see ourselves through that cross for your sake, so that in everything we do, you might be honored and that we might maintain faithfulness and be able to say, like Paul did at the end of our lives, I've kept the faith. In his name, in the name of Jesus, amen. Are we doing the Lord's Supper next? I don't have my... Is that what's next? No song? Okay. All right. I hope you have your... if you don't have it, you can go get it. The pandemic elements. We celebrate the Lord's Supper. We call it the Lord's Supper for two reasons. One is that the New Testament calls it that, so we choose that name. And the other one is this. We don't invite anyone. We don't exclude anyone. This meal belongs to the Lord, and he has given the requirements for participation in this. And there are two of them. One is that what is symbolized in this ritual has been fulfilled in our own lives. You see, not only do we have the bread, which symbolizes the body of Christ given for us, not only do we have the cup with the juice, the grape juice, as a symbol of the fact that Jesus' blood was shed for us, we participate in the symbol in that we take the bread and we take the cup. And we raised empty hands to, in light of what Jesus has done for us, we've committed ourselves to him in faith because of his death and resurrection. And that the fulfillment of that part of the symbol has to be true of us if we're going to participate in this meal. So if you're here today and you're not yet a Christian, you're not yet made that commitment, I want you to know you shouldn't take the elements. You're welcome to be here. We're glad you're here. You're loved. If you have any questions, we'd like to answer so that you can come to the place where you can make that commitment. But it would be appropriate for you not to take the elements. The other requirement is this. The Bible says when Paul talked about to the Corinthians about their participation in the Lord's Supper, he said it was possible to partake of this in an unworthy manner. And what did he mean by that? Well, he said you have to examine yourself before you do that so you don't partake it in an unworthy manner. I think what he meant is this. If when we examine ourselves before God, we realize that there are some ways in which we have been disobedient to God that we haven't taken care of with him, we've got to deal with that first before we take the supper. And here's the promise we have. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we agree with God in his assessment of the things that we're doing wrong, and we acknowledge that before him, the obligation is gone, the stain is cleansed. And so what we're going to do is take a moment to examine ourselves before God. If God brings some sin to your mind, acknowledge it to God, renounce it, and you can participate in this meal cleansed, accepted. Let's pray. We thank you, our Father, that as we are seated before you in your presence, thinking about our own lives, that in front of us, in our hands, and in some of the symbols around this room, we see the symbols of our forgiveness purchased for us once for all time. And know that through the death of Christ, we are cleansed from all our sin. We can enter into your presence with boldness and joy. We thank you for that reality. And we thank you for the continuing fellowship we can have with you through him. In the name of Jesus, amen. I want to remind you that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he celebrated the Passover meal with his disciples. And as was traditionally part of that meal, he took bread and he gave thanks for it, broke it, and passed it out among his disciples. But then when he did that, he reinterpreted the meaning of that bread when he said, "This bread is my body, which is given for you." And then he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." And by that, he intended for them to understand that within a few hours, what was going to happen to him was going to be arrested, put on trial, and then executed. But that was something he was doing voluntarily for their sakes. Jim, would you give thanks for the bread? Amen. Okay. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is given for you." And so we do this in remembrance of him. Amen. After the Passover meal, Jesus took the third cup of wine, which was traditional. He gave thanks for it and passed it out among his disciples. But when he did that, he reinterpreted the meaning of that cup when he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins." And by that, he intended for them to understand that his death wasn't just any kind of death. It was a death by sacrifice. That's what that phrase "poured out" means. And that it was going to establish a new kind of relationship between God and human beings, one whose foundation was the forgiveness he was going to purchase through his sacrificial death. Carol, would you give thanks for the cup? Amen. Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant, my blood, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins." And so we do this in remembrance of him. Let's pray. Lord, the Apostle Paul said that in the logic of the gospel, the right response is to offer ourselves to you, a living sacrifice. That's our true worship because of all that you've done for us. And so, Lord, even now we say in our hearts that we want to live for you. We know that's why you died for us, so that we may live for you. And we know that you're enough, no question. But we pray, Lord God, that you would enable us in our lives, step by step, moment by moment, to worship by offering ourselves in all of our decisions and all of our actions for you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Please stand as you're able for the closing hymn.
There is a truth than ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. A kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom.
Please receive the benediction. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. To one who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Amen.